Hi everyone, welcome to lesson 19 of my free beginner course. In this lesson we're going to start our first concertino, Opus 11 by Ferdinand Kuchler. And I have here a very old piece of sheet music. It's actually from when I was 8 or 9, I don't know when I started playing this, with some notes from my violin teacher back then. I'll say in a sec what they say. And we'll be learning the first movement in this lesson. If you're thinking, what is this free beginner course and who are you? I'm Slata, I live in Holland, I'm a professional violinist turned stay-at-home mom, and I'm sharing my art and skills online. If you missed the previous lessons of this course, then you can go to this YouTube playlist. You can follow along all lessons that prepare you very well from scratch to getting ready for your first concertino. And you can download the sheet music for free at violinlessonsforfree.com. But what I would recommend is an awesome app, and I'm going to tell an embarrassing story about it. I am the type of using Urtext sheet music and stuff, and I've never used an app for sheet music, but we had a lockdown and my pianist and I didn't see each other, didn't rehearse for over 3 months. And then we played the Debussy sonata together, and we really had some trouble with the rhythm there and, you know, fitting everything together. But suddenly it worked. But we didn't practice for over 3 months, and I also had an injury in those 3 months, so I could only carefully play scales. So I asked her, do you know why this suddenly goes better? And she said, yeah, I have this awesome app. It's called Tongue Play, and it allows you to play along with the violin part or the piano part. So you can hear both parts or just one part. You can play it at any tempo and the pages turn automatically. It's really awesome. So I went to check it out and I saw that all these student concertos and sonatas and concertos that I play myself were all in this app with great recordings and sound quality. It's amazing. And I'm very happy to announce that I've partnered with Tongue Play, and you have the opportunity, besides that you can download a free PDF of the sheet music at violinlessonsforfree.com. You can also play this if you've practiced this with Tongue Play. I've got a free trial for you of 14 days if you follow the special link in the video description, and a 30% discount if you use the code VIOLINLOUD30. But I'll put all the details in the description, otherwise I'll say something that's not right on how to do it. So I'll describe that in the description. Now first, to get to know this piece a little bit, here is me playing together with my awesome accompanist, Tongue Play. Thank you. Well, and now I have this precious memory of my violin teacher when I was 8 or maybe 9 years old. And the main feedback she wrote here was mind the second fingers. Of course, it's in Dutch. And on the G and D string, you have a high second finger. And on the A and E string, you have a low second finger. And we've already practiced that in the etude and in the scales that we've done before that. So I think you got it, but I just wanted to share, also that I did that wrong back in those days. So again, we can travel back in time because I have from an old course a tutorial on this concertino. And I want to share that with you. It's the 2016 Slato, probably says a lot and probably speaks even worse English than I do now. So I want to share that with you and that gives you some pointers on how to practice this. So enjoy that tutorial. Let's start with the first part until bar number 24. The piece starts forte, and I really want you to play this piece a little bit cocky. Some people play it a little bit careful, like this. But it isn't really exciting. So what I want you to do is that you make beautiful musical sentences and that you really play it very loud and with confidence. And this was the first musical sentence, this ends here. And how you play a musical sentence is that you need to find the highlights and that you need to start the sentence with a little crescendo and end the sentence with a little decrescendo. Otherwise, it will sound quite flat. So you make it with these dynamics within the forte, you make it a little bit more exciting. Well, the highlight of a sentence is most of the times literally the highest note. In this case, it's the D you find in bar 12. And what you want to do is that you play the C after that a little bit softer. Well, we start forte, but we do a little crescendo on the first note. And you heard me playing this highlight on the D, but also in a bar before, you want to play those four quarter notes. You want to play towards this high D, so instead of, this is not really exciting. Well, need to remind yourself that we are in G major and that you have to play your second fingers on the G and the D string high, and on the A and E string you play your second finger low. But that's something you can practice with the scale exercises that go along with this part and with the etudes by Wolfhard. So you play a G major scale and you play the Wolfhard etudes number 3 and 4. So this is the first sentence. There are not many difficult technical things in it. The second sentence starts in bar number 13. It is a little bit similar and it has also a highlight. So you want to play that last note a little bit softer, and the two D's you find in bar number 14 and in the last note of bar 15, you want to play them a little bit louder. And generally you can play louder if you go up in pitch and go softer when you go down in pitch with some exceptions. So these were the first two sentences. Now we get something different in bar number 17. A little comma. This is your highlight, and a lot of students, because you come from with a low second finger, play this B, so the fourth finger on the E string, they play it too low. So what you need to do is that you, if you have this mistake, if you make this mistake, you have to play it a little bit higher. It's always dangerous to say, because if you're playing it in tune already, then don't play it too high. Because I said this, and then continue the rest of the sentence. so you need to play that in the right rhythm. Mind in bar number 21 that you have first a low second finger, open string, and then the high second finger. So don't play that second finger somewhere in between. So this sentence is a little bit different than the others. So you need to really to let people hear that. And you can also play quite some open strings. You see that it gives some clarity also to the sounds. Well, make these three first sentences very beautiful and let people hear that the two first sentences are a little similar to each other and that the third is really something different. Now we are at bar number 25 and we start with some eighth notes. Well, if you have to determine the tempo in which you're going to play this piece, then first look at eighth notes and see at what tempo you can play them very neatly and very comfortably. You don't want to play a piece at your max tempo, but you want to be a couple of percent below that. Because what you will see is that if you play at 100% of your ability, then you will see that in the performance it goes wrong. So you want to be slightly below that. So really master all those runs. You don't have to play this really fast, but it has to match the tempo of the first couple of sentences. So if you're up to playing this whole piece and you want to determine tempo in which you're going to do this, because it's quite flexible, see in which tempo you can play these eighth notes comfortably. Well, there are a lot of scales in these runs, and that proves again that it's very important to study your scales, because then you really have that actually ready in your fingers. A mistake a lot of people make with these eighth notes is that they use too much bow, and then it becomes very sloppy. So what you want to be doing is that you play in the string, so you play quite firmly. We're still playing forte, by the way, so don't just play forte in the first couple of bars, but maintain the forte until actually bar number 39, where you go to piano. So this must all be forte, but with just a little amount of bow. Otherwise you also can't play it in speed, but you get something like... It doesn't sound very nice, even if you can do it. What you need to do is that just a little part of the bow, and you play slightly below the middle of the bow. Well, here we have all those scales. And then we go further with the up bow. And then we see that we have the same structure actually as the first three sentences. Because actually your first sentence is this one. Something similar. And then something different. What you want is that you hear the first note a little bit louder in the first note of the four, and certainly the first note of the bar. So we have... And that's a little bit more exciting than if you play everything kind of flat, dynamic wise. Well, if you have difficulties with these runs, the way to practice it is using rhythmical variations and variations in bowing. What I mean by that is that we have these bowing of the first two notes slurred and the other notes apart from each other. And what you can do is play them first without slurs, or play them all with slurs, or slur them by four, like... And what you can also do is play them all without slurs, but in different rhythms. So, and these kind of things. What you can also do is play them by four very quickly, but with a pause then. So you play something like this. So make up your exercises. It doesn't really matter exactly, that's why I'm going through this so fast, what kind of exercises you make up exactly, as long as you practice variations. So don't just play it through again and again and again and again, because that's not a very effective practice strategy. Well, after this follows 6 bars of a piano solo, actually. In bar number 39, we come to a completely different atmosphere. While we were very forte and cocky and with confidence, now we have a piano, but something's written down there, ma espressivo tranquillo, which is that it needs to be calm but expressive. So please don't play this piano like this. Because then it doesn't have any expression left. So even if you play piano, you always have to remind yourself you're playing a concertino and you are the soloist, and you must always be able to be heard above a grand piano. So you can see that forte then is really, 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 really loud, and piano still has to have sound and some core and still has to speak. Well, we also have some alterations here. So mind them. We start in bar 39 with a high second finger. So there's a sharp before the G, it becomes a G sharp. And we have the same thing in bar 41 with the C, that is C sharp. So all high second fingers. Well, what you see in bar number 44 is that the G is a G again, so low second finger. And in bar 45 we have something else, but I will get to that. Let's first play through the stuff from bar 39 and really work on this. It takes some time to get a good sound from your violin. Here we are, bar 45. We first a high second finger, and while you play this second A, you already place your second finger right against the first finger. So you get. And for the audience to be able to understand what you're doing, you have to play it very clearly. If you're playing it very doubtful, then it gets. It's like you are making a mistake or something. So really, perhaps put a little accent on these, on the G sharp and the G. So it really sounds like you're doing it deliberately. Well, then this same atmosphere goes on until bar number 54. So we have a little bit different. This is this part until bar number 54. And you can play an open E string on bar 53, but with your bowing, make sure that it doesn't sound like something like that. So you have to play this open E string with a lot of care, actually, so it doesn't sound like, what's that? the same thing, I'm playing it a little bit on the upper half of my bow. That's where you get this sound for this part the best way, actually. So this was the romantic part of this part. In bar number 54 we make a transition from this romantic and soft atmosphere again a little run in mezzo forte. It's very important to play this bar number 54 with a lot of care. So this transition is something people can follow easily. So we come from this, and then you have a crescendo on the. And these are two up bows. So, and you don't play something like that, so don't do something spiccato-like. But play it very simple and just stop your bow in the middle of the bow. So don't think too much about it, but keep your bow on the string and make long bow strokes, because there are lines below the notes and not dots. Well, in these two notes you have to go to the mezzo forte in bar number 55. Then with the eighth notes, it's very important that you bow smoothly. That it doesn't sound like etc. etc. So we come from this espressivo. Mezzo forte part. What I recommend is that you do a crescendo within this mezzo forte, because you're making actually the transition to the reprise, so the theme that comes back in bar number 63. So that's very important, and also these kind of runs can be really boring if you're playing without any dynamics or anything else. So just to talk you through them, we start then in bar 55 and play as smoothly that you can hear. Actually, you throw the notes into the room, and you need to hear them sounding at the same time actually. So you need to have some resonance in them. That's very important. So otherwise it sounds too flat again. Go a little bit back, and then suddenly it's nice to do this a little bit louder, and then put a little kind of, not really an accent, but really that people hear that you're going to this C instead of a C sharp that they would expect from bar number 57. So you really need to play that in a way that people understand that you're not making a mistake, but that it's actually deliberate. And you can play a little bit forte there, because it's really your ta-da! There it comes, the theme again. Well, the theme is exactly the same as in the beginning of the piece. We call this a reprise of the the general theme actually. So play it in kind of the same way, with confidence, be a little cocky. Softer. And here you need to retake your bow. And this is a very long note, so really count it out. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. Make sure you are at the frog. 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. And make sure this octave is in tune. You have them there, piano, and check your third finger. 2, 3, 4, 1. 2, 3, 4. So that was a little bit louder, and a 1. And here is a transition that might be a little bit difficult for some people. We are in bar number 84 and you have to go from the forte to again the piano ma espressivo. It's the same thing, just 5 notes lower than in bar number 39. And there is a ritenuto there and a decrescendo in that bar. So you really have to put some thought into bar number 84. So let's start in 83. 1, 2. And then a little comma before you start with the piano. It sounds very weird if you don't do all these things. It's very strange. People don't go with you in that. So try to, if you think about it, it will be... as in bar number 45. So first the high second finger, low, 4, and this piece can be a little bit louder. Then in bar number 100, you end up in a down bow, but you have to make that down bow a little bit short in terms of bow use. You need to close this section of espressivo and go to the mezzo forte there. So we have... come a little bit as a surprise, but it has to be a logical transition. So how you do it in bar number 100 is you have this last note, 1, 2, and so keep your bow on the string, don't do something like that, just keep it there and again, within this mezzo forte, so we have this dynamics in general, but you have also the dynamics within the dynamics, so a little bit change of dynamics within this mezzo forte. So a little bit crescendo, and then you go back a bit. Here, a crescendo. And don't play too loud there. You have to have something. You don't have to. Don't give it all away there, because there comes a fortissimo all the way at the end. So don't play at the loudest of your loudest in these bars. I'm going to start in bar number 104. Can do also to make this fortissimo a little bit more stronger is that after the first two bars of the forte, so after you go back a bit, not all the way to mezzo forte, but and here you go then towards the fortissimo. And here we have a double stop. You put your low second finger on the E string and your first finger on the A string. So the two fingers are right next to each other. And if you do vibrato, then make a vibrato even on that double stop. If you can't play that double stop, try it anyway. But if you can't play it, then just play the top note. Don't play if you have to choose one, then you use the one on the top and not the bottom one. Well, so this is the first part of the
concertino.
Okay, well, happy practicing with your first concertino. Just a little bit about what's going to happen in the next lessons, because of course we have a second movement, we have a third movement, but I want to prepare you very well to that, so you're not struggling with that, etc., etc. So we're going to play some beautiful pieces by Elgar, but we're also going to play La Vie en Rose by Edith Piaf, and of course I'll give you some etudes to hone your technique. So I hope you will stay with me in this free beginner course. Again, I will only continue it with enough subscribes and likes. So you know what to do. Subscribe and like, and see you in the next lesson. Bye bye!